Jack Miles is Distinguished Professor of English and Religious Studies at the University of California, Irvine. His book, God, A Biography, won the Pulitzer Prize in 1996. A sequel, Christ, A Crisis in the Life of God, led to his being named a MacArthur Fellow in 2002. Today, he shares his views on the quest for peace in the 21st century.
You know, a prophet like Christian de Chelcher, the abbot of that monastery, usually says something extreme, something very challenging, and engages in actions that will not be exactly duplicated by all of those who hear the message. They will receive it each in his or her own way, assimilate it and act on it, and the result over time will be a significant change, but it won't necessarily duplicate the action of the prophet himself. So the kind of conversation that is beginning to take place among religious leaders is only a part of an adjustment that may be taking place and may save our species, but it may not.
You've spoken eloquently about some monks, one of whom, in his vision of pacifism, thought he would die.
Pacifism seems fatuous to most people. It seems an impossible dream, something from another world, but not from the world that we live in. It's just not realistic. And I myself consider myself a soft pacifist. I don't believe that I could eschew violence through army action in absolutely all circumstances. However, I'm skeptical and observe that very often military action does not lead to lasting peace. And I'm not alone in this. There are some others who believe that reconciliation is the only way, and if some must pay a high price voluntarily to bring about reconciliation, then that may be their high calling. There was a ferocious civil war in Algeria not long ago in the 1990s between the nationalists in that country, all religiously Muslim, but not really very religious, and Algerians, also Muslims, who found their government oppressive and who, invoking their religion, wanted to organize and overthrow that government. So you had a civil war. And the Islamist side saw the established government as the heir, ultimately, to the old French colonialists who were Christians. And so they turned against the remaining Christians in their country, who included a small group of Trappist Cistercian monks in a monastery called Tibirine. The monks were advised by many well-intended people to leave the country. They chose to stay because they wanted their lives to be a testimony to the necessity of reconciliation between former enemies. And in fact, one night, the rebels came to their monastery, took them out, and killed them all. The abbot left behind a testament that will now be included in the Norton Anthology of World Religions, which comes down to the present in each of the traditions that are included. I'm serving as the general editor of that that work. And this is perhaps one of the more striking ones in the latter stages of Christianity in that anthology. He knew that he might face this as his end, but what he saw himself doing was not dying for the faith alone, He was dying for Algeria, for the people that he had come to that country to serve, the Muslims as well as the Christians. A futile gesture, time will tell. But unless we have a few people making gestures of that sort, that can be interpreted as having their secular function, you see, alongside their religious motivation. And you can parallel this structure when coping with any great peril, such as even oil shortage.
So you have a religious component to your thinking.
That's right.
About you and your God, but you also are part of a society.
And you recognize
and
that.
And he was, in his statement,
yes.
was trying to bring, so what did he want people to take away? What was that statement?
Certain things for him were more precious than life itself. And that which was most precious was reconciliation and peace among the various peoples of the world. So he was at pains to say to those who would be reading his words in France that the point was not to circle the Christian wagons, as we would say in the United States, and mobilize militarily against the Muslims of the world. It was the very opposite of that. It was to recognize that unless people would lay down their arms and make peace with one another, there couldn't be an Algeria. He was looking at Algeria, but there really couldn't be a world either, because the means of mass killing are now so widely diffused.
The focus of today is on the spiritual testament of a Trappist monk who was assassinated by terrorists in Algeria in 1996. And I would like to give you some statements of his spiritual testament, one at a time, and ask you to share with us the meaning that you would have us understand about each part of it. The first, if someday, and it may be today, I happen to be a victim of the terrorism which now seems to engulf all the foreigners living in Algeria, I would like my community, my church, my family, to remember that my life was given to God and to this country. What's he trying to share?
Well, the situation out of which this very carefully pondered statement comes is a very historically loaded one. The man's name is Dom Christian de Chergé, and he was the abbot of this very small monastery in the Atlas Mountains of Algeria. He did not aspire to be a martyr. He hoped that, in fact, he would be allowed to live on and continue the work that he was doing there as the representative of a small Christian community living in an entirely Muslim district. But knowing that it was possible that he might be assassinated, he wrote this spiritual testament and gave it to members of his family to be opened and read only in the case of his violent death. He had a background, as it turns out, in the French military. Algeria became a colony of France way back in 1830, and at a certain point it was actually incorporated into France. It was regarded simply as another province of the French Republic. But there was one difference between this province and the other provinces. Only the French colonists were regarded as citizens from that province. All the native Algerians were regarded as just natives. They had no citizen rights. So they were being taxed, they were being governed, but their government really did not represent them. Despite this essentially oppressive set of circumstances, quite a bit of cultural exchange grew up between the colonists and the Arab-speaking, religiously Muslim Algerians, the century or so that lay between the time of colonization and the outbreak of World War II. Algeria supported the French in World War I, and Christian de Cherche was just a boy at that time. However, though they supported the French again in World War II, they did so on condition that after the war they would be either given full rights as French citizens or allowed their independence. And in fact, on VE Day, Victory in Europe Day, when Germany finally surrendered, France was now completely liberated, there was a major demonstration in Algiers seeking this great change in the relationship between the Algerians and the other French, or the Algerians and the French. The reaction of the French authorities was violent. A riot ensued. The loss of life was quite heavy. And there then began a period of hostility between France and its erstwhile Algerian colony. During the years 1954 to 1962, this was a full-out civil war with horrendous loss of life on both sides, but especially on the Algerian side. The estimates of how many died range from 350,000 to a million dead. And Christian de Cherche was a French soldier involved in the pacification efforts of France against the local population. The local population were fighting back the way populations do in a circumstance like that, with the tools of guerrilla warfare and terrorism, the only tools available to them. And in fact, while on patrol one day, Christian de Cherche was surrounded by hostile Algerians, and his life was about to be taken from him. As it happened, though, he wasn't on an ordinary patrol that day. He was patrolling in the company of an Algerian Muslim who had become a dear friend of his. Sometimes they would walk while he was on patrol. Often they would simply take long walks together and talk about their lives, talk about their beliefs, and talk about relations between their two countries. This Algerian Muslim intervened with the would-be killers and talked them out of killing Christian de Cherche, and a few days later, that man was assassinated for his pains, treated as a traitor to Algeria for having saved the life of a Frenchman. This action had the effect of changing the course of the life of the rescued French soldier. He began then to recognize that there was a profound religious spirit in the Algerian people. He conceived a new respect for Islam as a religion, and then was born his desire somehow in another capacity to return to this country that he had come to love. Years later, this happened. First, after leaving the military and completing studies, he decided that he had a calling to be a Trappist monk. And then a small group of other Trappist monks and he came back to Algeria, established their community in the Atlas Mountains, as I said. It included a medical clinic, and its intention was to take that landscape of pain and violence and endless vendetta. Each side had its accusations against the other. Each was sure that the next round of violence would finally pacify the enemy and bring peace. It never happened. And try to replace all that with mutual respect and even love. When, after Algerian independence, a civil war broke out within Algeria between supporters of the army and Muslim Islamist rebels, the situation of the monastery became an acutely dangerous one. But the Cherche refused to leave. A film, in fact, has been made about their decision. We can talk about that perhaps a bit later. But what he was afraid of was that his assassination, if it came about, would be made the occasion for a new outbreak of hostility between French and Algerians. And it was because he didn't want that to happen that he issued this statement, which he hoped would become public and would prevent that reading of his last hours on this earth.
He wrote this spiritual testament and gave it to his family to hold in 1994. And the second line of it has a they in it. And they, from the earlier lines, refers to his community, his church, and his family. So the line is, may they accept that the sole master of every life cannot be indifferent to this brutal form of departure. What did he want us to understand?
I think in that line, he was making a silent gesture to a Muslim tradition whereby God is the owner of all creation, including all life, and we who live our lives individually and have custody of one another's lives while living on earth are just his stewards. We're given custody of life, but it doesn't really belong to us. That, I think, is why he used that expression, soul master. He was attempting in this simple sentence both to say that human life is precious and we must all treat it as that. Whoever's life is at stake, lives don't come in categories. There's only one category, the human category. And to make a gesture toward the group that he knew might conceivably be responsible for his death.
He went on to say, may they associate this death with so many others just as violent, left in the indifference of anonymity.
Well, there he is speaking, I believe, as a Frenchman to the French audience that he knew would at least be the first audience that would hear this this statement. In fact, the statement now is known all around the world, and it has become rather emblematic or iconic in Christian circles, at least. But that reference to large numbers of people dying anonymously was a reference to the many Algerians who had died anonymously at French hands, some of them tortured to death in French prisons, many slaughtered indiscriminately in the kind of battle that is sadly so typical of guerrilla warfare in our time, in which the proportion of civilian to military casualties can range as high as 90-10. So he was looking back then to all the lives that France had taken as if to forestall any wave of hunger for revenge on the part of French who would hear about his death.
He next said, my life is not worth more than any other, nor is it worth less. In any case, it lacks the innocence of childhood.
Well, the innocence of childhood for him was the innocence of a French boy in World War I and the innocence of a young French man sent to pacify a French colony in his capacity as a French soldier. He was there, I believe, in about 1959 or so. The war ran from 54 to 62. The naivete in question is a confidence that right is on one side and wrong on the other side, and that violence committed by one side against the other side, so long as it is by the right side against the wrong side, is innocent violence. He wants to say, really, there is no fully innocent violence. We are all guilty. There is always complicity when this kind of action is taken. He doesn't want to declare his life forfeit or worthless as if he were some kind of suicide bomber. He's quietly repudiating that too, and insisting that his life too is precious and that he wants it to continue. But at the same time, he wants to recall the attitudes that have been taken by his country and by himself as well.
He explored next a feeling of complicity with evil in the world. I'd like to read that major passage. I've lived long enough to know my complicity with the evil which, unfortunately, seems to prevail in the world, and even with the evil which might suddenly strike me. I would like, when the time comes, to have this moment of lucidity, which would enable me to ask for God's pardon and that of my brothers in humanity, and at the same time to pardon with all my heart the one who strikes me down. There are two themes in that, the complicity and the pardon.
Right. Well, I'm not a young man myself. And I can look back on a lifetime in which some of the time I was doing harm and didn't know it, and some of the time I was doing good and didn't know it. There were times when I was a party to actions that in retrospect I wish I could have dissociated myself from. They seemed innocent at the time. My intentions may have been good, but the effects of my action were bad. And similarly, actions that I've engaged in casually without thinking twice about it have on a few occasions been crucially important to other people. We're never entirely the masters of our own lives. We're always having effects that escape our intentions. So humility is called for, and I think he's speaking in the first instance for a kind of humility, confessing that whether he knows it or not, he's probably done some harm. Whether he appreciates it or not, he may have done some good as well. And what he says about himself is true about everyone else too. People have hurt him who didn't intend to. People have done good for him who scarcely realized they were doing it. In a circumstance of that sort, we must each greet our fellow man, our fellow human beings, particularly in a shared time and place, in the mood of mutual forgiveness that he speaks about. Forgive and ask forgiveness. Humility on both sides can bring us past the need to continue killing each other.
He said he didn't wish his own death, but he did it in a much different context. And I'd like to read you both that statement and the context. I cannot wish such a death. It seems important to testify to this. I do not see how I could be happy to see this people whom I love to be indiscriminately accused of my death. It is too high a price to be paid for what is perhaps called the grace of martyrdom. by an Algerian, whoever he may be, especially if he says he is acting in fidelity to what he believes Islam to be. I know the contempt in which Algerians are held.
Well, here we have the very delicate confrontation between someone who could easily enough be described as a Christian suicide fighter of a sort, and Muslim suicide killers, suicide fighters or suicide bombers. He doesn't want to be counted in that number. He also doesn't want his death to in any way facilitate the portrayal of all Muslims as suicide bombers or suicide killers. And he knows that this has been done. He knows that there's been a leveling, a kind of stereotyping of an entire population into conformity with the views and the conduct of a few. Mind you, this is all in advance of 2001. This is not a post 9/11 event. This is prior to all that. It's not in an American context. It's in a French context. But we also have to remember that the European experience of terrorism was large before America began seriously thinking about this issue. And so he has plenty of points of reference for the statement that he's making. He is not someone who is mentally ill, infected with a death wish or anything of that sort. He's also not someone who is anxious to throw away his life so as to provoke some kind of mass reaction on the part of his fellow Christians against Muslims. That is a kind of a strategy that's known, as I'm sure you realize, in terrorist actions. Bring about a spectacular, ugly assassination, and you may inflame your fellows, you may inflame your citizenry to take action, violent action that you wouldn't be able to take alone. He's trying to keep himself clear of all that, though he recognizes the danger.
He juxtaposes the idea that the person who assassinated him was acting in fidelity to his beliefs about Islam with what he addressed next was the caricatures of Islam. This is what he said. I also know the caricatures of Islam, encouraged by a certain idealism. It is too easy to think that one is acting in good conscience by identifying this religious path with the fundamentalisms of its extremists. What's he trying to share with that juxtaposition?
I think I've said it in commenting on the previous line. He doesn't want all of Islam, all of Algerian Islam in particular, to be made over in the image of the FIS, the Front Islamique de Salvation Nationale. That was the group that won an election, was denied the right to take power by the Algerian army, and then went into resistance, went into the mountains, with a legitimate cause, one would have to say, at the outset, that then was betrayed by the violence with which they pursued it and the indiscriminate slaughter that they enabled of Muslims who disagreed with them, and of all foreigners and Christians. There was the wherewithal then for quite a bit of a stereotyping, and it did occur. He wants to dissociate himself from that, and I think he's looking back as well as forward. He doesn't want everything that he has done as a monk living in a small, very peaceful community in a remote location in Algeria to be sucked into a dynamic that has nothing to do, well, it has something to do, of course, to be sure, but it doesn't share a common agenda at all with what he and his fellows were attempting to create.
He next likened, or more properly drew attention that for him, Algeria and Islam had a body and a soul. Here's what he said. Algeria, Islam, is something else for me. It is a body and a soul. I have proclaimed this often enough. I believe this, as far as I know and have seen. So often finding in this place this leitmotif of the gospel learned at my mother's knees, my first church, specifically in Algeria, and already respecting Muslim believers.
Christian de Chargé had come to a kind of despair with regard to the at least immediate religious future of France. He thought that France was a country fairly irretrievably sunk in superficiality and hedonism, that though it was a country that had built great cathedrals in the past, it wasn't going to be building any in the future, or bringing about any other kind of spiritual construction in another form that would bear comparison with that exalted past. Redemption, spiritual redemption, was going to have to come to France, he thought, from outside its borders. And he saw, in fact, a promising starting point in Algeria. That's why he makes this unlikely connection between the Christianity that he learned at his mother's knee, casting his mother as one of the remaining true Christians of France, and the soul that he came to know in Algeria. Soul and body are inseparable. If he had not gone to Algeria, if he had not established dear friendships with Algerians, and friendship is a bodily matter, isn't it? You have to see the face, you have to hear the voice, you have to touch the hand. Then he wouldn't have been able to come as close as he did come in his conviction here that he shares with us to the soul of Algeria. And the soul of Algeria and the soul of Islam, if not entirely identical, are certainly in a close relationship. So as to make knowing one part and parcel of knowing the other. So his agenda is one that is for Algeria, but it's also in a way through Algeria to others in the world, other Muslims in other countries, and other Christians and post-Christians and atheists and anti-Christians in his home country.
He'd obviously given careful thought to what some others might think, putting himself in the circumstances to be assassinated. I'd like to read that to you next. Clearly, my death will appear to justify those who would quickly dismiss me as naive or as an idealist. And he quotes, "Let them tell us what he thinks of it now. But they should know that this will finally liberate my most burning curiosity. How can your death be a curiosity?
The meaning of that statement, the meaning in particular of that final word, curiosity, I think comes out in the following words. Could you read on a little bit further?
For God willing, I will be able to plunge my vision into the Father's in order to contemplate with him his Islamic children just as he sees them, all illuminated with God's glory, fruits of his passion, clothed by the gift of the Spirit, whose secret joy will always be to establish communion and reestablish resemblance while enjoying the differences.
You know, he's a real monk. He's a real Catholic Christian. He believes in the afterlife. And he knows that people are going to laugh bitterly, but laugh they will, that he who was so confident that French Christians and Algerian Muslims could live together in peace should end as he has ended, assassinated as a French Christian by an Algerian Muslim. He is curious to see what Algerian Muslims and French Christians are going to be like in heaven with God. And he imagines them all clothed in glory. Their resemblances now are unmistakable. Their differences remain real, but they are a cause of further glory and only of beauty. He's curious to see how this will work out. He's confident, and only crazier than ever, I'm sure, his detractors would say, to justify his actions on earth by suddenly invoking the afterlife. But this is the way religion works. You know, it does transpire on two planes, and actions that take place here, namely his willingness not to flee, not to do the commonsensical thing and take shelter when hostile people are after him, and instead to try to bear witness to the possibility of harmony between these people. He motivates this action by his faith in the larger arena that he sees himself playing in, which includes an afterlife in which he may be vindicated.
His next statement, I give thanks to God who seems to have wanted this lost life completely mine and completely theirs for heaven's joy and everything and despite everything. What does that mean?
Let me read it in English. In this thank you, which says everything from now on about my life, I, of course, want to include you, friends of today and tomorrow, and you, friends here, beside my mother and father, my sisters and my brothers and their families, repaid 100-fold as promised. And then we come to the climax. And also to you, friend of the final hour. The friend of the final hour is his assassin. He's imagining himself confronted with his assassin. You who will not know what you are doing. This is an allusion to Jesus on the cross, who said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Yes, I also desire this thank you for you and this adieu foreseen for you. Now, he capitalizes in French the word merci and the word adieu. Merci in French simply means thank you. Adieu can mean thank God. So merci adieu, it would be translated in English as thank God. So he imagines himself confronted by his assassin saying thank God. But adieu in French also means goodbye. So he is simultaneously saying thank you, goodbye. Thank you to whoever he wishes to thank, God. Mm-hmm. and adieu to his assassin. And in French, that is followed by, that adieu is followed by envisager de toi, which means face to face with you. But it can also mean imagined by you. So thank you to God as imagined by you, my Muslim friend, with the knife in your hand. He wants to respect the right of this man to entertain an idea of God and even erroneously to believe that God is calling on him to perform a great service, even at that hour. At the same time, he's saying goodbye to that man, and the envisager de toi can mean face to face with you. I'm face to face with you, and I'm saying goodbye, and I'm saying thank you. It's a remarkable multiple vision, and he alludes again to the crucifixion in his final sentence. May we be allowed to meet again as happy thieves in paradise, if it pleases God, Father, to both of us. Amen. Jesus was crucified between thieves, and one of them said, remember me when you enter paradise, and Jesus says to him, this day you will be with me in paradise. So this is his attempt to be true, to imagine himself. Who knows whether he really succeeded? Who knows how he conducted himself in his final moments? But this is how he would have wished to conduct himself, at least. And this is the vision that he entertains of mutual forgiveness, even at the moment when one is suffering the greatest injustice. Here he is, someone who has dedicated himself to friendship between the French and the Muslims, being assassinated for his trouble by an Algerian Muslim. But he's being true to his convictions down to the end and hoping that how that man imagines God will now be affected by what he has seen at the time that he slits the throat of his victim. Actions of this sort are crazy. They can't be made to add up under the ordinary computations of power politics, economic politics, reasonable self-interest. They transcend all of that. And when they occur, sometimes they come and go, you know, like fireflies in the night. Sometimes they don't have any discernible effect. But one never knows. Sometimes a seed has been planted. Sometimes a model has been presented that can be copied and imitated. And the model that I think is particularly relevant for Americans here, because our country is so powerful and has wittingly or unwittingly been involved in so much oppression, is the kind of honor, the kind of courage and religiously motivated devotion that can take place between the oppressor and the formerly oppressed. It's only natural that the formerly oppressed should hate the former oppressor. Should the former oppressor then just run away and hide, keep out of harm's way? Or should he put himself in harm's way in the hope of helping to create a deeper relationship between the two? Well, it's clear what position on that Christian de Cherche took, and the fact that his action has stirred so many people, has attracted attention so far beyond what would have been expected. This film, Des Hommes et des Dieux, of Gods and Men, based on the story of these seven monks struggling not to run away, deciding to stay, and then losing their lives, won the Grand Prix at Cannes. It stars the very distinguished French actor Lambert Wilson, and has had a remarkably long run in American movie theaters. I expected that it would go very quickly. It hasn't. It has lingered. So that's the lesson, I believe, that can be drawn from this remarkable story.
Professor Miles, thank you for sharing with us today your insights into the role of religion in the quest for peace in the 21st century.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.